moving straight on to our next speaker, who's Dr. Teresa Reedy. Teresa is a political scientist in the Department of Government, University College Cork. Her research interests lie in the areas of public finance, Irish politics, and she publishes widely on these topics. She's currently leading a comparative project on voter facilitation and engagement practices funded by the EC, and she is working on the most recent general election and abortion referendums. Teresa is co-editor of International Political Science Review. She has given expert evidence to parliamentary committees, the Constitutional Convention and the Citizens' Assembly, and is a regular contributor to media.
Thanks very much, Mick. Thank you very much for the invitation to be here today. I'm going to take you back to kind of public policy, and in particular to a poor relation of public policy in Ireland, which is basically this talk is going to be about local government or the lack thereof in the Republic of Ireland. And the main thing I want to say in the kind of takeaway message is that Ireland is odd. We are extremely unusual in how concentrated power is at the centre of politics. All kinds of policy decisions in relation to health, education, public transport are taken at local level in other countries, and almost everything that we do in relation to public policy in Ireland is actually decided at central government. And that really makes us weird in European terms. And the even stranger thing is that we never talk about this. We spend a lot of time talking about our electoral system and how we could tweak that and fix that and it would fix something else. And we talk a lot about our public transparency and accountability and all kinds of other mechanisms, but actually the kind of elephant in the room in terms of our governance system and how it compares to other European countries is how centralised we actually are. And that's more centralised than other small European countries. So we often think, well, you know, what about Luxembourg? What about, you know, Cyprus? What about Belgium? Well, we're actually more centralised than pretty much all of those countries. And I want to start off with a chart here taken from a report on governance arrangements produced for the European Commission in 2015, and it's very easy. This is us here in the end, and this is an index of local autonomy. So how much power do local authorities have to actually act on behalf of their citizens and to implement services on behalf of their citizens. And that's us there, laggardy last, right at the very bottom. And the other thing to say is, in relation to this report, it shows quite clearly that actually Ireland has gotten worse in the last number of years. So decisions that we actually took during the course of the crisis actually made things worse. Between 1990 and 2014, actually local autonomy improved in a lot of other European countries, but we went in the other direction. We went from, okay, third last, but third last to actually last in terms of what you can do at local level in Ireland. Just to put a bit of flesh on that, what are we really talking about when we talk about kind of local governments and kind of local autonomy arrangements? We're talking about where the levels at which we have elected governance in Ireland. So where and who do we elect? How many of those structures do they have? What kind of powers do they have? What kind of legal protections do they have? And how much money they have? And that's really, money is the crucial thing, because you're just, policy without resources is actually dreaming. It's not going anywhere. And I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of one, two, and three here. There isn't much to say about the relationship between central government and local government in Ireland, other than local government does what it's told, and that pretty much captures the whole relationship. When we talk about layers of governance, there's multiple layers of governance, and particularly in Europe, we're used to this idea of decisions being taken at several different layers. So the one that we hear about all day, every day, on the radio, on the TV, is central government. So the national government sits in the capital and they take decisions. We're all reasonably familiar with the European Union as a kind of a layer of governance above. What we're a lot less familiar with in Ireland is the idea of layers of governance below and actual real decision-making being taken at layers below. In Ireland, regional government, which probably in our case would be probably provincial government if you were going to design it on a kind of a serious or thought out way, is pretty much non-existent. We set up regional governance structures in the 1990s in response to decisions taken at the European level, and most of it had to do with bringing European funding into Ireland. So this is what regional government governance looks like in Ireland, partly because we want more moolah from Europe, so we want regional government. We designed it in such a way so that we could actually attract in more money. So we carved up the country and the regions in such a way that we could kind of claim greater social disadvantage so that we could get more money. But we don't really have any realistic or reasonable tier of regional governments. Local government is more interesting because we actually have a long history of local government in Ireland, a history of local decision-making going back 1,000 years. In the 19th century, local government really took on more structured form, particularly around the time that they were making more serious reforms of local structures in the UK, and there is a rollover from Britain. But upon independence, there was actually a reasonable structure of local administration in existence in Ireland. We had county councils, we had county borough councils, which then became known as corporations, which then became known as city councils. And there's a message to this. We had some borough councils, and the borough councils became urban district councils. We had lots of town commissions, then they became town councils. And we had rural councils, which were the first to go. We got rid of those in 1925. But the main story of local government structures in Ireland is that we spent the last 100 years fiddling and finicking and changing them, but mostly abolishing them. So we went from a situation where there were several hundred councils in the country, lots of layers of decision making, to now actually having 31 local authorities. So local structures are really an endangered species in the Republic of Ireland, because the main approach we take to them is actually abolishing them and rationalising what it is that we what it is that they do. In 2014, an entire tier of local government, town councils, were actually abolished and taken out of the system. And there's a comparative European report which was done, which shows that Ireland has what we call the territorial upscaling, so in terms of increasing the size of local districts and reducing the powers they have, we had the second highest territorial upscaling in Europe in the last 30 years. We do this, it's very similar to some of the things that people were saying earlier this morning, we do this without any discussion, we do this without any debate, we do it without any sense that it has impacts in the way in which decisions are made, and particularly without any reference to the fact that it's taking out local knowledge and local voice from key aspects of decision making. One of the things that did happen in 2014 is that public participation networks were established, and those were mentioned as well earlier this morning, and this was an attempt to bring back in more diverse voices, but it was done in, it's probably part of the reforms that were successful, but in a way it was kind of bringing voices in, but ignoring the fact that taking out a whole layer of local authorities was actually unbalancing the scales quite significantly. Now, it could be just the fact that in Ireland we're maybe more efficient, that we don't need local government. Maybe the system runs really, really well and we don't actually need these local authorities. But I just want to kind of put us in a bit of a comparative context to kind of understand a little bit about what it is, how it is that we structure our local authorities and what it is that we expect our local authorities to do. And just in terms of the number of local authorities here, I've put in a couple of different countries, but in particular I've put in a couple of other small European countries that are kind of like us. Belgium, Denmark, Finland, small, relatively wealthy, old democracies. And you can see how quite different we are in terms of the number of local authorities that we have, but also in terms of the average population per authority. So in Denmark, you have about 55,000 people living in each local authority area. It's much smaller in Finland, 15,500. In Germany, those visions of inefficiency and waste of money, they have actually 6,500 people per local authority. So we never hear about the structures of local governance. We never hear about the way in which public or local democracy and relationships between kind of citizens and public representatives work at local level. In Ireland, it's 140,000 per local authority unit, and we only have 31 local authorities. So it's really just to kind of reinforce this point that we are odd in comparison to our European neighbours, and this really does actually kind of set us apart. And in particular, that each councillor is actually serving a large cohort of the public. And somebody made reference, I think it was Paddy Cosgrave this morning, talked about how there's a perception of councillors and TDs, you know, being very engaged in their local communities, and that's not necessarily the case. Well, the evidence is a bit mixed on that, but one thing we can say is if you look at the ratio of public representative to citizens, it's just not possible for public representatives to engage in that kind of service to their constituents, because the scale is just impossible. It's far out of sync with most of our European neighbours. And remember that our councillors are part-time. They're not paid a salary. They get a small stipend for the work that they do, and they are expected to carry a very heavy caseload. So at the end of kind of a number of years of reform, particularly since the economic crisis, where are we left? We have fewer councils, we have fewer councillors, we have a far greater ratio of citizens to representatives than they do in any of our European neighbours. So as citizens, we have far less voice and far less opportunity to actually influence decisions that are taken at local level. The next thing I just want to kind of say a little bit about is in terms of what do local authorities do. So we're odd in terms of the number of councils, the relationship to the councillors, but we're also really strange as well in terms of how limited local authorities are in the kind of financial decision and financial structures that are in place. Here we're fortunate enough that kind of Malta are worse than us, but what this table actually shows you is this is the percentage of revenue that's actually raised by different layers of government. So how much taxes are raised by central government, and what proportion of taxes are raised by regional government, and what proportion of taxes are raised by local government. And that's us there, second from the bottom. Basically, local authorities in Ireland have very little capacity to raise revenue of their own. And there are consequences of that. It means they are very much dependent on local or on national government for the kinds of services that they can engage in. They have to be allocated money from the centre. If they don't have their own autonomous taxing powers, they have much less capacity to actually do things. And it means that there's that imbalance. Everything is decided at the centre. And the same thing you can see here in relation to spending. This graph is organised slightly differently, but again, actually, in this one, Malta is the only country that's actually worse than us. And you can see that the dark pink part of the bar is actually the spending by central government, and the purple part is the spending by local government. And just compare us to any of the other European countries. Most of the spending in some of those countries is actually done by local government and not by national government. So we are very, very unusual in that. I'll just skip this one to kind of move along quickly. This is a table. And the first thing I want to start with is the column on the left-hand side there. Those are the main categories of things that actually local authorities spend money on in Ireland. So some of them you'll be reasonably familiar with: housing and building, road transport, water services, recreational amenity, agriculture, education, health and welfare. The second column shows us that between 2005 and 2014, actually there was a big increase in spending under most of these categories. But remember now, this covers the boom and most of the bust. But what we can see is that in some particular categories, there's been sharp falls in spending. And I particularly want to draw your attention there to health and education. A lot of things that used to be done at local level are no longer done at local level, because there's actually a strong centralising mentality that's evident in policy making in Ireland. So when problems emerge at local level, the kind of impetus tends to be to centralise the service and deliver it at national level, rather than actually looking at ways in which services can be delivered more efficiently at local level. They're just like a couple of things. The amounts within these categories are relatively small. They're declining in several areas. And just a kind of an odd point, which is totally separate, but I work in public finances as well. Only in Ireland would you have a 90% increase under the miscellaneous category, which is otherwise known as we were too busy to actually fill out the forms properly. And nobody even did anything about it. This is just going back to the same categories, but just to make a couple of points that more recent years, very specific items have actually been taken away from local government in Ireland. Water services and Irish Water is a debacle that we don't really need to go into. But I think the two that are really important here are health and education, because these actually account for the major amounts of spending in most other European countries, and in Ireland too. But in most other European countries, actually a large proportion of that spending is actually taken, the decisions are actually taken at local level. And just to give examples of that, that means that the funding of and local primary schools, where the local primary schools get built, the construction of them, the maintenance of them, the hiring of the teachers, the same in relation to primary healthcare, where the GP surgery is going to be built, hiring the doctors, paying the doctors, all of those decisions are actually taken and maintained at local level in other European countries. And if you take it kind of a step back, there's a degree of rationale and integration of thought behind that, because local authorities are also responsible for deciding where we all get to live, where the houses going, where the new housing developments going in, where are the population needs going to be, what are those population needs likely to look like. That knowledge exists at local level. So there is a huge amount of sense and rationale behind having that kind of decision-making integrated and put together in other countries. In Ireland, we've gone in exactly the opposite direction. We established the Health Services Executive in 2005 to deliver more efficient healthcare in Ireland. Susie came up a moment ago in relation to the third level grants. Those used to be administered by local authorities. They were doing a really bad job of it. They have to be a little bit careful about local authorities in Ireland as well. They don't always have the best record. But instead of investigating how it could be done better, Susie simply centralised the delivery of these services and transferred them to national level. And that really is the kind of history of local government in Ireland, is stripping away certain powers and allocating them to central government. Just to kind of add in a few other small pieces as well, differences between us and other European countries, local authorities in Ireland don't have any capacity to make policy. They can decide where speed ramps go in your community, but that's the kind of policy decision-making they actually have, the kind of policy autonomy they have. The legal way that Irish local government is established is that it is a policy taker from central government. And it's different to other European countries, where when new social issues emerge, there is a vague space where local authorities have the possibility to actually step into that space and begin to deliver services and eke out a balance between central and local level. That is not possible in the Republic of Ireland because of the legal way in which local authorities are set up. Powers are allocated to them, so they can't actually develop those themselves. They have no roles in all kinds of areas like policing, the courts, and other particular areas. Does it matter? Well, we end up with this kind of false dichotomy, which talks about efficiency versus accountability. So yes, we had more accountable public services when they were being delivered by local authorities, but the local authorities were corrupt, they were inefficient, so therefore we centralise the services and we get more efficiency. But this is a false dichotomy and it's a false argument, and it's not one that's accepted in other European countries, where the evidence is fairly clear that big is not necessarily better, big is not necessarily more efficient. And there's a lot of international research actually demonstrating this in relation to local government. One kind of thing that's worth noting is our budget cycles are more pronounced because we don't have more devolved revenue-raising powers. And in particular, the property taxes are really worth noting here. A lot of other European countries raise a great deal of money through property taxes. And property taxes are attractive because property is immobile. You cannot take that wealth with you and move it to another country. And most people actually tend to go to quite considerable distances to pay their property taxes. So it's controversial in Ireland, but property taxes are actually seen as a very left-wing initiative in most other European countries and as a significant contributor to dealing with wealth inequality. And they have this huge advantage that they're a stable source of revenues. But we haven't properly introduced our property tax. There's still too much control over the property tax at central level. So even though the revenues go to local government, they're very restricted in terms of how much they can change it, whether the ceilings in terms of what they can increase in extra revenues. And that has consequences because it means the revenues are a much smaller proportion of the total revenue. And also, when taxes that are more affected by the business cycle are hit in a downturn, there's less stability within the system. So if we raise more revenue from stable revenue sources, we wouldn't be as prone to these swings and roundabouts that we get in our budget cycles. And the last one is regional development, but I think I've probably gone on a bit too long at this stage. But I don't think it probably requires much to say that we haven't really delivered substantial regional development. We have a very imbalanced approach to economic development, and that's something that emerged fairly significantly in the later years of the Celtic Tiger, but was very much on the agenda again at the 2016 general election in terms of the recovery, how it was concentrated in one part of the government, one part of the country, where the resources flow to, the relationship between kind of urban development and rural development in Ireland, and that particular acute imbalance. And a lot of that has to do with the way in which political voice is structured and where political power is located and who gets to actually have a say or a voice in political power. And I'll just leave you with this last one again, just to reinforce the point that we are odd. We are definitely out of sync with our European neighbours. And the next time you hear somebody talking about changing the electoral system or changing other parts of our parliamentary structures, abolishing a House of Parliament or something like that, why don't you ask them to start with local government in Ireland and local power? Because that's where we are acutely different from our other European neighbours.
Thanks very much, Teresa, and plenty of food for thought there, I would have thought. Gentlemen down here, yeah, we'll start off here. Just sit down there if you like.
Hello, Jerry Kerr. Thanks very much, Teresa. I had to say something because I'm on the PPN, Dublin City Council, and I'm a passionate believer in it. But I have to put a word of caution to you. I would think that the reason city managers rather than councillors have powers now is because of all the corruption that happened right throughout the country. And most things that we do in Ireland, that we do at a local level, whether it's water, medical cards, traveller sites, you name it, it doesn't work at local level. It's too patchy and it's influenced too much by locals. One last example I give you,
It's working.
Hello. Just 6 months ago there, I'm privileged to be on one of the SPCs in Dublin, and I asked councillor friends of mine, why on earth were they voting for putting a seafront wall down 6 inches, which would take cost half a million to cut, when they'd all agreed to have it at this height, and that they were expecting within 10 years that they'd have to rebuild it anyway. And the reason I got from every one of the councillors across all the parties were, because if Sinn Féin votes for it, I'll have to vote for it, I lose votes. And right across the, we did this crazy thing. So maybe there is some sort of a balance there, Teresa, where we can go too far. I agree with you totally that we cut it too much under Phil Hogan. But at the same time, I think I like Central.
Go ahead.
There's no getting away from the poor history of some parts of local government in Ireland. It was riddled with jobbery and corruption for a very long time, but so was central government. And a lot of that was actually rooted out of central government, and central government was professionalised. And actually, local government has been professionalised in terms of the people who work there as well. But the presumption is always in Irish policy making that if you centralise the service and deliver it at national level, or at least set the parameters at national level, that it will be done better. And that's just different to the way that it is in other European countries, where decision making is taken at the closest level to the citizen. And I think there is
is a strong kind of culture of anti-politics at the moment. And it's a culture that we see in Ireland, but also in a lot of other European countries. And there are many different roots, causes to that. But one of them is actually to do with the setting, the quangoisation of politics, and a narrative around the quangoisation of politics, which says we can't trust politicians to do anything. We can't trust them to make decisions because they're only going to deliver for this constituency or that constituency. So let's set up a quango to do this, and we'll put it at one remove from the political system. And it's in and of itself actually accepting political failure. It's saying politics is incapable of doing these things. But it's not fixing the root cause of the problem or looking at why it is that we can't trust local decision making. It's just finding a route around it. And in many ways it might be exacerbating or exaggerating the problems that we already have there, which makes people less trustful of the political system as it is. And one example, just quite recently, it was one of my own colleagues that was on the radio talking about the Peter Casey effect at the presidential election. And the solution that was advocated was taking away the nominating rights from the councils. That was going to be how to fix the problem of Peter Casey. Just take it away from the councillors and there'll be no more of these kind of candidates on the agenda. And I think it kind of comes from a place where our automatic default solution to everything is actually to strip powers away from the council. You can build coherent, transparent, accountable systems at local level. It just takes a little bit of effort, and it's not an effort that we have ever really bothered to engage with in Ireland.
Just, Teresa, on that note, you mentioned the presidential election. There would have been a perception, I'd be interested in your view on it, that in a number of those nominations, they were done on the basis of the councillors had the power to do it, and they wanted to use that power irrespective of whether it was using it for a person they believed in or whatever. I mean, doesn't that feed in again to the perception that people have about politicians at that level?
I mean, I think it does in one level, but I think the other part of that argument is that they have so few powers that maybe actually they like to use the ones that they were given, you know, because they really have very little that they can do. And I would just say as well, though, a number of local authorities did have actually the power to nominate, and they chose not to use it. They actually interviewed candidates, and they decided not to nominate. So, you know, there's a discussion to be had.
Yeah. Contribution area from.
Do you think that vote at 16 might have an impact at local level in terms of, I mean, I sat in the Shannon when it came up for debate with a group of young people. We even had the T-shirts ready to put on afterwards because we were convinced that it was going to pass. And then a senator came out and explained, listen, we won't be supporting ye tonight, but we will in the future. And the young people looked at me and said, but the debate hasn't happened yet. And I had to explain to those young people, no, the decision is made in the background, and the debate is just for show. And that could have, if that had passed in the Shannon that night, then local elections in May 2019, 16 to 18 year olds could have had an influence on their local work. When I work with young people, they don't see themselves in local government when they look inside those buildings. But do you think that vote at 16 might change that dynamic somehow?
I don't think the vote at 16 will have much impact on local government. And the main reason for that is because I don't think the general electorate know what local government or local authorities actually do. I think generally the public think that local authorities look after roads, do some housing stuff, and that's about as far as it goes. And I wouldn't fault young people for not knowing very much about local government at all, because nobody knows very much about local government. But on a complete, you know, on a relational, I think votes of 16 is just a no-brainer. It's so obvious that is a really progressive and important step forward. And lots of evidence to say that if we actually registered young people to vote when they're living at home, we did it systematically through the maybe the education system, and we provided them with voter and education. Voting is something that is a strong life cycle effect. If you start early, it's habit-based. You're much more likely then to vote subsequently. So it's straightforward. I think we should definitely think about that, but will it fix local government? I doubt it, really, to be honest.
Okay, we take the two of these together if we could, then we might finish here. Just both, yeah.
Thank you very much. Niamh from Throker, thanks so much for a really fascinating presentation. I'm just struck by the slide that's still up, some of the countries listed at the other end of the scale to ourselves. Some like Finland or Sweden or Norway who crop up sort of at the top of the kind of indexes that we were looking at earlier today. And I was just wondering, is there, you know, any analysis or that, you know, that relates or correlates stronger local level decision making, greater decentralized decision making, and sustainable development outcomes at all? Is there any sort of connection at all?
Just take the one as well, Larry.
Thanks, Teresa, for that. Just a couple of things, I suppose. The input of the Laois County Council there had a significant input in terms of what was the ultimate conclusion around the Port Laois Hospital. We've all heard about it in a national perspective, but it really does consolidate very much what you were saying, I feel. You know, the consultants, the GPs, the public in general, the sense of protest, all of that. I know the minister arrived down at one stage at a very short notice, didn't wish to have even the media know and met with the council. And look, I think in fairness, we're at a very advanced stage there, and I think it's been for the common good. It's quite close to my own heart. Our daughter was born in there, and it was in months on either side of ultimately some of the situations that were shared nationally. I suppose some of your sharing certainly has only consolidated my sense of input to the PPN and to even to drive on harder. We were told at the National Conference that there are some more monies coming down the line, and you know, in view of what your insights are, I think it's probably a little wonder in terms of the kind of redress, maybe what the shortfall from past approaches have been. All right, thanks.
If I just pick on the last point, I think one of the things, I mean, the 2014 reforms were a bit of a mixed bag. On one level, the town councils were just abolished, gone, 75, we don't need them anymore. But there were some positive things, actually, in the 2014 reforms. And kind of two of them in particular were the devolution of responsibility in areas around social and economic and community development. So previously we had lots of city and county enterprise boards, and those were all actually integrated up into councils, and councils were given a much stronger role in terms of local economic development. And that had been called for about 30 or 40 years. So that was a step in the right direction. And there was also the establishment of the PPNs, which are the kind of different community pillars, and they have a voice, and they can contribute more systematically now in an organised and structured way into community development policy making within the local authorities. So those are positive things, and they're definitely going in the right direction. What needs to happen now is to have those roles significantly expanded, but expanded with local autonomy, so that local authorities get to actually raise their own revenues to actually spend on those areas, and they make the decisions about which kinds of schemes they're going to run, over which time period, how they're going to evaluate them. So those are the kinds of things that they kind of really need to develop. So some things were positive. Just abolishing a tier, I think, is really problematic, but definitely there were steps in the right direction. In terms of the question about kind of sustainable development and local decision making, that's a little bit mixed, and you can't directly compare some of these countries either, because some of them are actually federal countries, so there are actual multiple layers of governance. So you know, Switzerland is a federal country, Germany is a federal country, so decision making is actually spread across multiple tiers. But we do know that these types of structures give much greater voice to citizens, and it also gives much greater capacity for local communities to shape and to develop themselves. But to be effective, you do need to have a financial equalisation mechanism. So it's very important that built into any reforms that there is a redistribution process. So local authorities need to raise their own revenue, and councillors need to be responsible and accountable for that revenue. But we can't have a situation where pre-existing inequalities, for example, between regions in a country are reinforced by this. You have to have a system of equalisation where there is internal transfer of resources as well. But it shouldn't be just one or the other, it should be both.
Teresa, thank you very much for that. Very interesting contribution there, Teresa Reedy. Thank you.